of some of the nature of that hostility. What therefore do we in Jamaica, we in the People's National Party, what do we think are the realities with which we must deal? We are mostly cases of small economies. We almost all reflect that structural dependence which is the legacy of the long colonial experience. Without exception, the economies are deformed. All come to independence and are still proceeding on that path within the matrix of some form of dependent capitalism. There is therefore heavy dependence on external and unequal trade, heavy dependence on foreign capital, substantial foreign control in place. These are facts that I have no doubt have been amply reventilated at this conference. And what we see as the, you might say, the political environment in which we work is two clear trends of political activity which are present, of which we are a part, and with which we must deal. We deal with a powerful neo-colonialist reality. That is the first trend. It is a reality that is comprised of the traditional oligarchies, the multinational corporations, very often the army, and very often those elements of what we can describe as popular groups, the masses sometimes called, who have come from colonialism in a considerable state of dependent psychology. And associated with that are all the classic tactics of anti-communist propaganda and the willingness to resort to military force if there is the slightest threat to the power and position of the traditional oligarchy. And it is interesting that all of the protagonists of the neo-colonialist thing, whether they live within polite Westminster-style democracies or impolite military tyrannies, all have the common agenda of asserting that only foreign capital within the context of the status quo can do this job of development, meaning by that finding the answer to foreign exchange crisis, finding the answer to unemployment, finding the answer to the development of productive capacity. To the general thesis of foreign capital is now added, of course, the Reaganomics of supply side political economy, which is now stoutly championed even by our own Prime Minister in Jamaica. Against that, we identify the possibility of a broad alliance, very incomplete in its articulation, very uneasy in its political understanding, very uncertain in its sense of tactics and strategy. And it is those forces which have an interest in, or can be committed to, or persuaded to, the development of an independent path of development in which one is seeking, firstly, the assertion of sovereignty, particularly in the economic field, seeking to provide an economic foundation to political independence so that viable societies can emerge. In our own experience, and others can comment on this, in our own experience, we detect in Jamaica the possibility that elements in that alliance can come from a new class of entrepreneurs, sometimes called the patriotic private sector, as distinct from the traditional oligarchy of the latifundists and the major merchant traders. Obviously, the intellectuals and the professionals, and critically, the trade unionists, the workers, and of course farmers or peasants, if you will, other than latifundists, what you might loosely describe as a kind of enlightened popular force. And looking at that, I would like to suggest that a first strategic principle emerges in the struggle against imperialism, and that is the importance of not confusing the struggle against imperialism with a struggle against local private sectors per se. I think that one of the strategic tragedies that can occur is when people oversimplify both the nature of our possibilities and the nature of our realities by allowing a confusion to exist between an anti-imperialist struggle and a view of the role and place of a local private sector within each national conformation. Let us look very quickly, if we may, at what is the obvious economic and social agenda. And it is after that that I would like to comment on political strategy very much in the context of J. Mandel's criticism. Obviously, when we look at an economic agenda for each territory that can come within the political leadership, hopefully a legitimate political leadership, if I might quote Mr. Mandel, there is a very clear economic and social agenda which I think we derive from experience. Firstly, that there has to be the tightest and most consistent control of what we might call economic aggregates, that governments who bear this responsibility have got to begin with tremendous levels of fiscal and budgetary control. Secondly, that they have to determine and develop the clearest priorities over the use of foreign exchange and the prioritization of foreign exchange. Thirdly, that there has to be, again, the clearest sense of priorities in the direction of investment to strategic economic development. Fourthly, that there has to be major investment in agriculture aimed at the greatest and most rapid possible self-sufficiency in food, because this has tremendous implications for the internal use of resources, tremendous implications for the possibility of rural transformation, and immense implications for problems of foreign exchange, and immense implications for the very fact of having an independent polity that is not unnecessarily dependent on external sources to feed itself. Fifthly, there has obviously to be a very clear and precise program that deals with social justice, because without that there is no prospect of maintaining a mass momentum in what one is doing. Sixthly, that one has to work constantly and ceaselessly to explore the practical possibilities of regional economic cooperation and integration, and a whole lecture could be developed on that alone, the practical possibilities and challenges and the difficulties that one faces with them. And then seventhly, I would add, of course, that every sinew of effort, will, and intelligence should be strained to avoid dependence on the International Monetary Fund. Political agenda. And here I would like to suggest a second strategic principle. It is one with which we were even more unfamiliar many years ago than we were in the case of the strategic principle about tactical alliances in the struggle against imperialism. And I would put it in this way, and that is that those who are concerned to develop a political process committed to the effective development of economic independence must avoid the populist seduction that is inherent in traditional democracy. And here I would like to pause to say very precisely and exactly what I mean. Because I think this is one of the hearts of the matter, of what we think we have learned, and how it relates to Mr. Mandel's strictures. I understand populism as meaning, in its most favorable interpretation, the assertion by a political process of its intention to do good works left, right, and center, to do all those things that everybody would like to have happen immediately. Perhaps that's a crude oversimplification. Bear with me. For instance, to talk about universal free education before one has examined the resource demands of that, the financial implications of it, is populism. Similarly, with universal health services, the assertion of it, the putting of it, for example, into a political platform, in the absence of a clear understanding of how, why, and with what, is populism. And I would suggest that there's no way that we who seek to be part of the struggle, which is your concern here, can hope to compete with the neocolonialists in the politics of promise. They will outpromise us every time, and every time that we rest our own political process on ill-considered promise, we sow the seeds of reversal for our own process. Because when the hard realities have emerged after 3 years in office and the promises are not met, nor in prospect of being met, what happens is you create a convulsive rejection, psychologically and otherwise, of the kind of program to which you are committed, and immediately a receptivity to the blandishments of the neocolonialist who says if you're only on all Ron's good side, you'll get all the goodies that you need. And this path, therefore, demands, I suggest, a rigorous adherence to serious political education within the ranks of the political parties that are concerned. And I mean by political education, not merely saying that we would all like to have free education, but rather a political education that examines, first of all, the nature of colonial history, the nature of the world political system and how it operates, the nature of imperialism, the nature of colonialism, of neocolonialism, and the nature of budgets and how they are constructed, of national finance and how it is organized. So that at the simplest levels, perhaps, one begins to develop throughout a process cadres whose knowledge of their political environment is increasingly mature and sophisticated. Granted that this is at the heart of political work, serious political education, rather than populism or even sound political organization, which is also important, there has to be a rigorous adherence to the principles of mobilization. That is the development of the techniques for ensuring not only that people understand as best one can what are the challenges and difficulties, but have some idea of what is the part they can play in finding solutions and answers. And of course, if both political education and mobilization are to have meaning, then one has got to design institutions of participation that create genuine functioning links between party cadres, people in communities, and the decision-making process at both the party level, the national level, and the community level. It is true, I suppose, what up to a point when Mr. Mandel says that the Caribbean is short of models. I might remind him that we are also, not in self-excuse, but that we're also a little short in historical experience. His own society has been at this for a couple centuries longer than many of ours. Not too strong on participatory techniques itself, incidentally. But I agree that he would enjoy the luxury that he's in a society that perhaps does not need to concern itself. I accept his strictures because we have no choice. We have to learn fast, and we'd better learn fast or we are doomed. So I'm quite clear about that. And you know, I would like to give, if I may, if you're not utterly exhausted by now, I'd like to give just one or two examples of the sorts of things of which one speaks, and then an example of how we are trying to go about it for what it is worth in our party, and then we can go to the awards, which I believe will bring us to a close. But very simply, if you look, for example, let's take some practical issues. Let's come out of the scholarship for a moment and get down to the nitty-gritty of what governments have to deal with. For instance, if you've got a tremendous shortage of resources at a moment in time, your taxes are at the limit of where you think you can take them, and you're short of ideal educational facilities, ideal health facilities, the sort of answer that we have got to be able to find, if we are to maintain the credibility of the process and its ability, therefore, to pursue our chosen path, is you've got to be surely find ways to mobilize communities to accept a self-reliant responsibility to make contribution even to things like the maintenance of school plant, to the condition of hospitals, not as a permanent condition, but as a way of mobilizing people to bridge the gap between, on the one hand, an absolute fiscal and budgetary responsibility, which you cannot avoid, and on the other, the improvement of human facilities that are so important. And why this is critical is that your choices are either to allow the hospitals and the educational system to rot, in which case the masses will turn against you and spit you out in due course, or you will try to buy your way out of the problem by spending money that is not backed by resources, and in no time you will be in a foreign exchange crisis, and in no time you will be deep in the arms of the International Monetary Fund. So therefore, realistically, you can both promote an answer and also teach a principle of communal self-reliance if you find an answer in mobilization. How often do we face the problem in Jamaica that a drive towards domestic agriculture, which is critical to the development of your human resources and the use of your land, it runs afoul of the massive resistance of the centuries of people who are accustomed to a wheat-based diet or accustomed to salt fish imported from Canada.